Welcome to a brand new episode of B&B Movie Reviews. This week, we'll look at the film career of Iron Man's dad, a Norwegian monster flick, an animated Pinocchio movie that may or may not be for kids, and the latest from Will Smith. Stay right there.
I think we would be remiss to not discuss its effect on me. But it's harder to
ignore it. Well, I could sure love to miss that discussion.
Whatever's unfolding, funny or tragic, it's happening with the camera going. But then there's some part of me that feels like, oh, I'll miss something.
It was this idea that films kind of brought us together, and to this day, still do.
We all know about Robert Downey Jr., but what about Robert Downey Sr.? This Netflix documentary takes a look at Downey Jr. reflecting back on his time with his dad, working as an indie filmmaker, and documenting the time that he has left with him. Brian.
Brad.
This movie is very intimate. It feels yes. like a family film. It feels like I should not be there. How did you feel watching this movie?
I kind of felt the same way, but that's actually one of the things that kind of drew me in was the intimacy of the way that Robert Downey Jr. Opens up his life and his relationship with his father to let us see where just his relationship with his father. And I really, really enjoyed seeing that aspect of it.
The movie starts off as one thing and ends as another thing. It starts off as this sort of celebration of senior from the point of view of the son. That was wonderful and made me really engaged with the filmography of Robert Downey Sr., which I have very little familiarity with. You know, I'm a Criterion head, but I'm not that much of a Criterion head, apparently, because I haven't seen Putney Swope.
Yeah, I haven't seen much of any Robert Downey Sr.'s movies, and I knew of Robert Downey Sr. just with the audience's relationship with Robert Downey Jr., just from his early career all the way up through the MCU. So I knew of him as an indie filmmaker, but I didn't know much of anything about the films that he made.
Did this movie make you curious to go back and watch those films? How about that movie, Pound? I need to see that film.
Looked interesting. Looked very interesting. You know, it actually does, because I like the way that this movie takes certain clips from the films that Robert Downey Sr. made and how it injects that into this documentary to really correlate with what is happening in the documentary between the relationship between Junior and Senior, and where Senior is in his life, where Junior is in his life, and how those movies really are a reflection of their time together.
Yeah,
I thought that really worked.
Brilliant thing that the movie did for me was invite Robert Downey Sr. to make a film within the film. It was like a little trick that Junior does to get his dad engaged with the documentary process.
It's awesome.
Yeah, and to see him direct felt really special.
Yeah, it's almost like he was making a contract with his dad to make this Netflix documentary. It's like, okay, we're going to make this documentary, but his dad's like, no, I want some say, I want some agency in this. So it's like, okay, well, why don't you make your film within the documentary? And even you have scenes with Senior sitting down with his editor and editing some of the B-roll footage that we're seeing in the documentary. So I kind of like that meta idea. And also, it's also showing us a way of how Junior is connecting with Senior within this documentary, which is what I like.
As the film progresses and we get closer and closer to the end of days for Senior, that's when it becomes, again, like this is a very private moment that's now very, very public.
Yeah.
And I was very grateful for both, for everyone, for the entire family, for allowing us to watch this moment. And it was very easy for me to go back in time to experience what it was like watching my dad watch his dad fade away.
Yeah.
And this movie ended up being a very cathartic experience for me, dealing with those emotions and also the emotions of grief that I'm going to have in my future, too, preparing me for that.
And that's one thing I appreciate and liked about this film is the way Robert Downey was able to open up his own personal life and the vulnerability of his life to the audience and how it will connect with us, with other people who may be dealing with similar situations, whether it's loss and grief and things of that nature, where it does feel very cathartic for not just Robert Downey Jr., but for seniors as well, and I appreciated that very much.
Junior allows some of his therapy sessions to be recorded on screen, and I was very surprised by that, but I also liked and appreciated how it normalizes therapy.
Yeah.
You know, to see Robert Downey Jr. call up his doctor and say, like, hey, I'm having difficulty being here with my dad in this moment. Help me.
And how to reconcile with his past with the last days of his father. I thought that that was very therapeutic as well to see. And you're right. I love the way that they normalize that. What's a rating that you would give for this?
It's a high B+. I think it's one of the best documentaries of the year.
Same. I give it a high B+ as well. I haven't seen a lot of docs this year, but out of all the docs that I've seen in 2022, this is definitely one of the best ones. So, yeah, those are our thoughts on Senior. Stay right there. We're going to take a look at another Netflix film, Troll, when we come right back.
When I got the opportunity to get her, there wasn't no choice. I told myself, I'm going to take custody of my daughter. It's my baby. That's what we're supposed to do as men. Take care of our home, build a foundation, you know what I'm saying? Love, our money, she's my purpose. I'm here to walk with her, hold her hand until she can walk alone. Ain't nothing like being a father in this world.
A giant troll awakes after 1,000 years in captivity, destroying everything in its path as it approaches the city of Oslo in the Norwegian monster flick, Troll. Troll, Brad.
Troll.
Now, I gotta say, coming into this movie, I'm a little bit biased because I'm a huge fan of the director, and there's some other Norwegian films that are kind of in the same vein that I'm a huge fan of. Now, the director is Roar Uthaug. Great name, Roar. Love that.
Love it.
He directed a Norwegian disaster flick called The Wave. And he didn't come back for the sequel, but there's a trilogy of disaster flicks. There's The Wave, The Quake, and then there's another one that's called The Burning Sea. And I'm really taken as far as, like, how Norway and these Norwegian films are able to really make these kind of disaster films on a budget, but yet focus on character and story. And Troll is a movie that I think does that, maybe not as effectively as some of those other films, but I think it does it in a very effective way.
Well, the movie, to me, is a Michael Bay disaster film. This is Armageddon, but instead of an asteroid heading to Earth, it's a troll storming through the Norwegian countryside. And I enjoyed all those sequences of government officials running together, trying to figure things out, because when the troll appears, not everyone is sure exactly what kind of disaster they're facing. There's a lot of crumbly rock, the mountain has exploded, a lot of dust. What is that figure? I'm not sure. It's a troll, but the government doesn't know that.
Yeah.
But they go to a paleontologist, Nora, and she's got some know-how and a little history with her dad. that gets her to thinking, maybe we got a troll attack.
That, what did you think of that? What did you think of that relationship? Because that's something that drew me in, and one thing that I was looking for going into this movie was the was that interpersonal relationship, because you see that in some of the other Norwegian disaster flicks that I've seen, that I mentioned, The Wave and The Quake. So that relationship with her dad is something I was expecting, and they did kind of deliver on that.
But it is also the same relationship from Armageddon. It's Liv Tyler and Bruce Willis, right? So...
But Bruce Willis is not as crazy as this guy is.
No. This guy's like Steve Buscemi in Armageddon.
There you
like,
go.
This guy's a little kookier.
Yeah.
But he has every reason to be, because he knows about trolls, and everyone keeps telling him that there's no such thing as trolls.
Yeah.
And that's where my frustration with the film lies, okay. Is that we see a troll, all right? We know we're now dealing with a troll. The troll is a kaiju attacking and destroying everything in its wake, and yet people are going like, let's not talk crazy. Like, we've seen the troll, we've attacked the troll, we've had helicopter battles with the troll, but we still want to go like, let's not do what Nora wants to do, because that's too kooky.
Yeah, because, I mean, they really, in the beginning of the film, they really dive into a little bit more of the mythology of the trolls. And I think, like, from the government standpoint, it's hard for them to kind of buy into that or to believe in that. But again, you're seeing it with your own
eyes. Yeah, they're firing rockets at it. It has no effect.
Yeah.
The troll is smelling the blood of Christians and coming after them. But they don't want to talk about the religious angle at all. And I like and appreciate how the movie wants to have a conversation about Christianity coming into Norway and the trolls wanting to reject that Christianity and gobble up that Christianity. I like the introduction of that conversation. I wish it was explored a little bit more. And again, I wish the government got on board a little bit quicker.
Yeah, it's interesting that you say that, because now, thinking about the movie while we're talking about it, I'm seeing a lot of those different themes and that, some of that commentary in it. While I was watching it, that stuff kind of blew right past me. So I really didn't kind of see that. I was more focused on kind of some of the interpersonal relationships between the father and the daughter.
I wish
that changes halfway through the film.
Because
I think that happens. What happens, that arc happens midway through the film, and then it kind of is a downward
slope. What's the point of the movie after that?
Yes, it's a bit of a downward slope after that. So it started to kind of lose my engagement from that halfway point, but...
Gotta say, though, the troll looks pretty cool.
The troll looked pretty cool.
And again,
man, that goes back to what I was saying about, like, Norway. And, like, you see disaster movies that are made here in the States, and it's more built on spectacle. Which is, I love, you know, I love Godzilla, King Kong.
There's a lot of spectacle in this movie.
There's a lot of spectacle in this movie, but you also have to think, like, they don't have the budgets that we have over here. So for these movies to look as good as they do, and you really got to check out The Wave and The Quake. Really, really.
I don't know. I feel like I need to rewatch Armageddon. I really like that.
It wouldn't be a bad rewatch either. I might actually rewatch that myself. But yeah, I just like the way that they take these smaller budgets and make great effects and focus on character and story.
And the earnestness of the storytelling is strong. I appreciate
it
that. It's not winking. We're not having a jokey movie here about a giant troll.
No.
This is a troll attack. We all got to get serious.
It's a very serious film, which I appreciate too.
I like that.
I like that. I like that as well. So when we return, we're going to take a look at another. Netflix is killing it, right?
A B minus.
I give it a B plus. There you go. There's our ratings. We're going to take a look at Pinocchio coming up next. Stay right there.
Each year, there are more than a dozen significant tropical and winter storms that threaten the East Coast. So chances are there will be more hurricanes and blizzards near here again. And between school, sports, and social lives, chances are you won't be with your kids when it happens. Will they know what to do? Ready.gov/kids has all the educational tools and information to make the conversation easy. When the time comes, chances are they'll feel prepared, not scared. So talk with your family today.
My sister's folly, the sentimental fool. She gave you life, Pinocchio, when you were not supposed to have it. No more than a chair or a table should. As a result, you cannot truly, truly die.
Oh boy, oh boy! And that's good, right?
Well, it means that you are not, nor will you ever be, a real boy like Carlo. The one thing that makes human life precious and meaningful, you see, is how brief it is.
Oh.
Death explains to Pinocchio that he cannot truly die because he is not a real boy in Guillermo del Toro's Netflix stop-motion animation film, Pinocchio. Guillermo del Toro, stop-motion, Pinocchio, classic mythology.
Yeah.
This is exciting, Brian. Were you stoked to watch Pinocchio?
I was. I was very stoked to watch Pinocchio. I mean, it's always great to get a new Del Toro film. And, you know, when you hear that he's doing stop motion, and he's kind of delved a little bit into animation previously, whether as a consultant on other films, but now for him to do stop motion, and stop motion is a beautiful form of animation. I like this movie. I have some issues with some of the performances. I think the character of Pinocchio, specifically in the beginning of this film, is a little grating on me.
The character or the performance? The voice.
The voice and the character.
Okay.
Because, I mean, he's... I don't know what to say about this kid, man.
Like, Pinocchio. You've seen Pinocchio. Like, what this film is doing is it is taking the classic fairy tale of Pinocchio that we've all experienced, probably most famously through the Disney animated film, and giving a little bit of a spin, setting it in World War II, wanting to have a conversation a little bit about fascism. I think Pinocchio fits nicely with Pan's Labyrinth and with The Devil's Backbone.
Definitely reminded me of Pan's Labyrinth.
It operates a little bit like a trilogy capper to those movies.
Okay.
And thematically, I think the movie is really engaging. I agree that maybe the vocal work, like I don't want to take down a kid actor. Like the kid doesn't need me to tell him that I don't like him.
He's a menace. I mean, poor Geppetto. I mean, Geppetto loses his son.
But that's what I like. I like that he's a little bit of a menace because he is new to life. Like, he is a little bit like a terror. He is a little bit like a toddler, a terrifying toddler. And that all works. And I loved Ewan McGregor as the voice of Jiminy Cricket living literally inside Pinocchio's chest.
I love that aspect of it. And in the beginning of the film, we talk a little bit about like some of the differences, how this version of Pinocchio is different from others, the setting, it being in fascist Italy, and the feeling like that is told from Jiminy's point of view.
Mm.
And the way the movie opens, like from his point of view, and he's almost as like the narrator telling the story, which I thought was interesting in the beginning to see that, and you know, having Ewan McGregor as the voice of, you know, Jiminy was great.
Yeah,
so.
Like I also was in awe of the design of the film.
Yeah,
this is a movie where you're going to want to buy the Art of book,
the
coffee table book. You're going to want that on your shelf. It does borrow design elements from a lot of other Guillermo del Toro movies. There's a lot of like flourishes that you will recognize from Hellboy 2, The Golden Army, and the aforementioned, you know, Pan's Labyrinth. But like, I think it all works, and it is a movie where you can hit pause and just sort of soak in the frame. And the Pinocchio design, whatever you think about the performance and the voice of Pinocchio, the design is really neat.
I like the design. I thought it different. It separates it from the Disney version and every other version that we've had of Pinocchio, which I appreciate that. And the way that his nose grows, how it grows literally like a branch.
How it could be weaponized.
Become
a tool.
Exactly. I like all that. Also like some of the themes that it's saying about life and death. You know, in the clip that we saw, you know, when Pinocchio dies and goes and he speaks to death and says that, you know, you can't truly die because you're not a real boy. And how he, you know, is kind of excited by that, but then also realizing that the people that you love, they will die. And he's like, there's a bit of a disappointment. And there's a little bit of a commentary and themes that are surrounding that Del Toro is getting into some more deeper and mature themes for an animated film.
And how life requires sacrifice. To join the human experience is a mortal experience. And, you know, to become a real boy for Pinocchio, he has to give something major up. And I liked that added wrinkle into the mythology of Pinocchio.
Yeah, and to Del Toro's credit, it's not a film that necessarily ends on a happy note.
No. It's a very Guillermo Del Toro movie. You know, like, I don't know if the world needed another Pinocchio film. Like, I was not craving it.
Yeah.
But I think it's clear that Guillermo Del Toro has a lot of passion for this story.
Yeah.
And through the execution of this movie, it makes me appreciate the Pinocchio story a little bit more than I did before I pressed play on it.
Yeah, I definitely appreciated the setting, the tone, and the themes that he was using this story that's kind of tried and true that we know of and telling something that feels very Del Toro.
We haven't mentioned the musical numbers, though.
Forgettable.
And that, if I had a big complaint, I just felt like the numbers themselves were solid. None of them were great, but they were solid. But they also just didn't really stitch together well.
Yeah, I almost forgot that it was even a musical because they kind of ditched the songs halfway through the movie anyway. What's your rating on this?
I give it a B+.
B+. Oh, goodness. I'm trying to think where I land on this. I want to go middle of the road, but you know what?
We don't do B's here, Brian.
I know. I'm gonna go a high B minus.
High B minus.
Yeah.
That just sounds like a B.
Yeah, but I'm gonna go B minus.
Okay.
Those are our thoughts on Pinocchio. When we return, we're gonna take a look at the latest from Will Smith. Stay right there.
Children are spending more time at home. Teachers, parents, neighbors, and friends, it's up to you to keep them safe. Now more than ever, it's important to stay connected. By phone, video chat, and social media. If you have concerns or see changes in a child, be there for them. Ask questions. Seek help. Report suspected child abuse or neglect.
Here are AARP top tips on caregiver preparedness during coronavirus. Form a team that can help with caregiving tasks. Take an inventory of essential supplies in your loved one's home. Make a list of the care recipient's medications. Schedule regular calls to fight isolation. Finally, take care of yourself too. Follow the Centers for Disease Control's guidelines for coronavirus safety. For more caregiving tips, go to aarp.org/caregiving.
You walk the earth because I let you. You're my dog now.
Perhaps you will give me some of that fine meat you give your other dog.
You're funny now, Big Stick. You'll see.
A battle of wits is played out between Will Smith and Ben Foster in this thrilling chase film that's set in the Louisiana swamps during the emancipation of slavery in the 1860s. So Will Smith is back, and we heard a little bit about this movie. I know I heard a little bit about him making this movie a few years back, and honestly, Brad, for me, it's kind of hard to kind of get myself to kind of watch another slave movie, another struggle movie. And I was a little bit hesitant, but I was curious to check this one out because I heard a lot of great things about Will Smith's performances, about his performance, the performances of all the other actors in this movie, the direction of Antoine Fuqua. I'm a huge fan of Antoine Fuqua. You know, he's had some hit and misses, but I found myself really getting into this movie.
I also was resisting pressing play on Emancipation because I too was not prepared to go through such a torturous experience.
Yeah.
That being said, once I did, I found the movie to be incredibly engaging and not exactly the torturous experience I was expecting either.
Same.
It is a thrilling chase picture.
It is
an action film. And I know some people hold that as a little bit of a detriment, like maybe we shouldn't be making such an entertainment out of this situation. But I never thought that it betrayed the emotional experience of any of the characters or the situation.
I didn't as well. And I actually like, and going to that point, I think a lot of criticisms that I've been hearing about this movie is maybe, I don't want to say the direction of Antoine Fuqua, but the fact that, you know, you have...
He's a thriller director.
He's a thriller director, and some people think that he kind of gets caught up in that, even in the movie that maybe shouldn't fall within that genre. But I think it works for this story that they're telling about this man. And then let's talk a little bit about Robert Richardson and some of his cinematography. That was one of the things that really pulled me into the film was the cinematography. We see that it's not necessarily black and white. There's very muted colors, but the way that he uses color in the film, between whether it's nighttime through the daytime, it's beautiful, like the choices that they make.
I think it's some of the best cinematography of the year.
Yeah.
And listening to interviews with Robert Richardson and Antoine Fuqua and the visual effects supervisor, Robert Legato, it was a very challenging experience to get the frame to look the way that it does.
Yeah.
To land on that, not quite black and white. You know, it's black and white at times. It's desaturated. They allow some of the greens of the swamp to come through.
Yes.
They bring in the firelight. They bring in the blood. They bring in the reds of the Union flag and the stars and bars. It's done poetically. And I responded very strongly to it. The movie is also a very spiritual film. It's about, yes, you know, connecting to a higher power. It's about connecting to God when you're going through an experience, a life like this. And the movie is shot a lot with, you know, bird's eye view, yes, drone shots. You know, like the spirituality is constantly being connected to the cinematography.
Exactly, and that's what I like. And those drone shots, those God's eye, bird's eye view that we get of, you know, of... Will Smith's character Peter going through the swamps. There's a, even though it's a horrific film, the nature of this is horrific, there's a beauty to the cinematography that just draws you in.
It's gorgeous, but it also never distracts from the horror of the movie.
It doesn't. And let's talk a little bit about that as far as like some of the violence in the film. I know off air we talked a little bit about one aspect of the film,
which I don't want to spoil necessarily.
Okay. But the way Antoine Fuqua decides to really not show, now...
He shows it, but he doesn't show it.
He shows it, but he doesn't show it. And I don't want to say that the movie is not violent, because there are some moments that kind of like...
The first 30 minutes are really horrific.
It's really horrific. And even towards the end, when we get to some of the battle with the Union troops, there's some shocking moments that happen when you see some of the Union troops marching and they're just...
That singular shot,
yes,
which you don't even know exactly what you are watching as the march is happening until other elements are introduced,
yeah,
and it was startling.
Yeah.
And then once that startle happens, you do not catch a breath.
It almost puts you in the position of Will Smith's character, Peter, in that moment, because, like I said, you're seeing that march, and almost the way he's reacting is the same way we're reacting as an audience, which was really, it took me back, because I didn't really know that, oh, the battle's starting.
Yeah, the perspective is tied to Will Smith's Peter. Throughout the whole movie, you're experiencing whether, you know, it's his exhaustion, his delirium, his terror, his strength. The movie is glued to his perspective.
It really is, but I found it fascinating.
And Smith is... really good in
the
movie.
He is really good. We're not going to get into that conversation, but he is...
Performance-wise,
the performance is
one of the best that he's given.
It's very deserving. Yeah. That's all I'll say. It's very deserving. What's your rating for this
one? B+. It's one of my favorite movies of the year.
Same. I give this a B+. Surprising, because going into it, I was not looking forward to it, not expecting it, but it really surprised me on all accounts, from the cinematography, the direction, the performances. Everything was great. A B+. So those are our thoughts on Emancipation. To kind of review what we discussed on this episode, Senior, we give B+. Troll, I think we are split on.
Yeah.
Brad gives that a B-. I enjoyed it a little bit more with a B+. We're split again on Pinocchio. Brad gives that a B+. I give that a high B minus. And we both are really high on Emancipation with two B pluses on that film. So that will do it for this episode of the B&B Movie Review Show. We will see you next time at the movies.